That's great. Thanks, Colin. And looking around, I see some interesting sights. I see that Jordan had a jacket on, and Sam had a suit jacket on, and Josh had a suit jacket on. So the boys in the flat, obviously, this morning had a little meeting and said that they had to get dressed up today. And then even I see my son's got a jacket on, so the message is spread. So I feel really underdressed this morning. I'm sorry about that. Well, anyway, I invite you to take your Bibles again and open them up to the Gospel of Mark. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 4. And thanks, too, to Peter Clark, who preached last Sunday morning, gave us an excellent message from 2 Corinthians chapter 4 on how not to lose heart. And it was a great practical reminder for us. We had a great discussion about it at our home group during the week. And so thanks, Peter, for doing that. I noticed that he sort of covered four chapters in one sermon, and I've taken like about 6 months to do four chapters, so I don't know if it was like a little hint or something to me, but anyway, I'll speed up a little bit today. I think I'll cover maybe three parables or something like that, but anyway, we're in the Gospel of Mark, and just to remind you that the Gospel of Mark is all about Jesus Christ. In fact, there are four Gospels, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and all of them are about Jesus Christ, and all four Gospels give us a perspective on Jesus Christ's life from the four different authors who are looking from four different perspectives with four different sets of eyes. But all of their accounts are true, they're all accurate, and they all complement each other. And the Gospels simply answer some important questions for us. They answer questions like, who is Jesus? Why did he come? What did he do? And then later on in the end of the Gospels, they will ask questions like, why did Jesus die? And did he really rise again? And if he did rise again, is he coming back again? And if he's coming back again, when is he coming back again? These are questions that all of the Gospels ask us. They're really, really important questions. In fact, these are life-changing questions that we need to know the answers to. And so that's why we're working through the Gospel of Mark together. And we've already seen in the first four chapters that Jesus is the Son of God. He's the Son of God. He is the Messiah. He is the King of God's kingdom. And he has authority over many things. He has sovereign authority over Satan, over sickness, over sin, over the Sabbath, over demons, over humans. He is in authority and has authority over all things. And we will learn that Jesus lived a perfect life. And we will learn, as we've just even remembered this morning, that he died a horrific death for our sin. And we've also learned in this Gospel of Mark that Jesus came as a preacher. That was one of his main roles, to be a preacher. And he preached the good news. He preached the message of repentance. He preached the message to help us be right with God. He preached the message that would help us have our sins forgiven. And so it's so crucial that we understand these Gospels, and it's more important that we understand who Jesus is. Well, a couple of weeks ago, we were introduced to the parables. And the parables were another form of Jesus' teaching. His teaching ministry in parables began at the beginning of this chapter, chapter 4, with the parable of the soils. And we looked at that, remember? The four different types of soils represented four different types of responses to the gospel, four different conditions of people's hearts. And just to remind you, a parable is a real life story that has a spiritual principle. It's a real-life story that that conveys a spiritual message. And Jesus started preaching or teaching parables about a year into his ministry. He didn't start with parables. It was about a year after his ministry began. And he started teaching in parables because chapter 4, verses 11 and 12 tell us that it was to, in some way, hide spiritual truth. It was to hide spiritual truth from the people who were not really very interested in listening to him. The ones who weren't really interested in following him. And I know that sounds a little bit unusual, doesn't it, when we think about it like that. But parables were designed to hide spiritual truth from those people who had listened to Christ over and over again. They'd listened to his preaching, but they had blatantly rejected it. They had the opportunity to believe it and accept it, but they didn't. They blew their opportunity. You know, that unbelieving crowd, those people who blatantly rejected the message, they might listen to a parable and understand the earthly aspect of it. They might understand how to sow seed in the ground and so on, but they had no clue as to its spiritual meaning. In fact, most of the crowd that followed Jesus, as we've been going through this gospel, we've seen that most of the crowd, they actually followed Jesus and they had no intention of following him as their Lord or as their Messiah or as their sovereign king. Most of the people in the crowd just followed Jesus because of their own selfish reasons. They wanted the personal benefits that came from it. They wanted the physical healing that Jesus was offering. They wanted Jesus to cast out their demons if they had any demons. And so Jesus didn't give them any more truth. That's why he started speaking to them in parables. However, for those people who were true followers of Christ, who followed Christ for the right reasons, the parables revealed to them new information, new spiritual information, new important truths. And you remember the disciples, they heard the parables and they may not have understood them straight away. Sometimes they had to have them explained to them. Jesus did that for them, but eventually they got the message. And as I said last time, we looked at the sower and the seed. And remember, Jesus told that parable to them. And then he explained it to them later on in private. Well, this morning we're going to look at some more parables in chapter 4, verses 21 to 34. These are just very short parables. And by the way, parables are primarily about the kingdom of God. Most parables begin something like this. The kingdom of God is like. And if you quickly look at verse 26 and verse 30, that's how those parables begin. The kingdom of God is like. And the kingdom of God is really, it's really, when we're talking about the kingdom of God, we're talking about God's rule or God's reign in your life. It's talking about the sphere of salvation. It's talking about God's authority. It's talking about his kingdom. And we are citizens of his kingdom. We are, if you're true followers of Christ, we are citizens of God's kingdom. And his kingdom has, what I understand, has sort of like a present aspect and a future aspect. The present aspect of God's kingdom is happening now, and that is the followers of Christ, those who are true Christians, they are following their king, who is Jesus. And it's more like a spiritual kingdom. But Jesus is ruling that kingdom. And then there's a future element of the kingdom that we believe will be happening one day in the future that we looked at when we went through the book of Revelation. And that is the thousand-year millennial kingdom when Christ will come and set up his kingdom on earth. And he will sit on the throne of David and reign over his people, over his subjects in the kingdom. And we will be there for that as well. And so what I want us to look at this morning is really just four characteristics of this kingdom, four characteristics of the kingdom of God that we see in these verses, in verses 21 to 34. Let's have a look at them now. The first one I want to talk about is what I've called shining lights. Shining lights. That is that kingdom citizens, those of us who are citizens of God's kingdom, are to put Christ on display. We are to shine out Christ in this dark world. Look at verses 21 to 23. It says this, and he said to them, that's Jesus, is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket or under a bed and not on a stand? For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. Now, these verses and some of the verses to follow, these are various sayings and various proverbial statements in these verses that not only appear here in Mark's gospel, but they also appear in Matthew and Luke's gospel as well in various places. And oftentimes these sayings are used in different contexts with different meanings, which makes it somewhat tricky at times to understand exactly what Jesus is meaning when he makes these statements. this passage can be a little bit tricky to interpret, and then obviously we need to interpret it and then put it into a sermon format. And so this has been a tough passage to think about this week as I've tried to think through what is Jesus wanting us to know and understand from this passage. But verse 21 begins fairly simply, doesn't it? It's a simple illustration. It starts off with a lamp. It's a lamp, and in those days, a lamp was like a little clay container. It was perhaps like a little terracotta saucer that had a handle on one end and a hole in it, and you would put olive oil into that lamp, and you'd have a wick going down into the olive oil, and then obviously you would light the wick, and then the wick would be fueled by that olive oil, and it would make a light, you know, about with a flame about an inch high, and you'd put those all throughout your house to light up the house. And it was a very, very common thing to do in the first century. In fact, there were so many of these little lamps around that if you went excavating around Israel today, you'd find them all over the place because there's just so many of them. But you'd take this little lamp and you'd light it and you'd put it on a lampstand. And a lampstand was normally just a little shelf that was coming out the side of the wall of a house. I mean, most houses didn't really have windows, and so you had walls around there, and you'd have a little shelf, and that would be where you put this lamp on the lampstand so it would light up the room. Well, once that lamp was lit, nobody in their right mind is going to put it underneath a bushel. Nobody's going to put it underneath. Literally, it is a flour bowl, a bowl that you would use for measuring flour. You're not going to put it under there. Neither would you put it under a bed, nor would you put it under a couch, right? I mean, if you did that, you would probably win the award for stupidity because nobody would even think of doing that. So why did Jesus use this saying? Maybe that's what we've got to ask ourselves. And why did Jesus use this saying? What's his point here? And maybe before I answer that, let me point out to you just a little grammatical issue in this verse here. For those of you who enjoy grammar, I know there's only about three of you. In fact, actually, Josh Whitford isn't with us anymore, so there's only two of you who actually enjoy it. verse 21 says this. Look at what it says. In my version, it says, it starts off, Jesus says, is a lamp. Or if you've got the NASB, it says a lamp. Or if you've got the NIV, it says, do you bring a lamp? And it's the word a or a here. It's a lamp. In the English, a, here we go, here it comes, is an indefinite article. It, in other words, if it's a lamp, it could be referring to any lamp, right? But that's not exactly what, well, not actually what the original text says. In the original text, it's a definite article. It should be translated this way, the lamp, not just any lamp, but the lamp. And you can check out your Greek grammars later on if you've got one. That's what it literally says. And so it begs the question, doesn't it? What lamp are we referring to? What is the lamp that we are referring to? Who is the lamp? Who is the light? And I would say that in the context of what we've been looking at in Mark, the lamp here is referring to Christ. He is the lamp. He is the light of the world. Jesus is, you could say, the lamp of God who has come to bring the light, who has come to bring new revelation about himself and about God's kingdom. So Jesus is the lamp. And remember, Jesus said things like, the kingdom of God is at hand and the kingdom of God is in your midst. And he was referring to himself. And so wherever Jesus is, the kingdom exists because he is the kingdom, the king of the kingdom. And he is also the lamp that would shed the light of the truth of the kingdom. And so in the context here, obviously, we are not to hide the light. It's pretty obvious, right? The parable says, or the proverbial saying says this. In other words, we are not to hide Christ. We're not to hide his message. We're not to hide his teaching about the kingdom of God. We're not to put a lid on his teaching like some people did, perhaps like the Pharisees did and many in the crowd did, and many do also today. We're not to put a lid on it. The lamp is to be seen. It's like we've almost got to throw away that flour bowl and make sure we don't cover the message with anything. We're to reveal him. Now, we know that there are always going to be people in our world and in previous generations who will abuse the light. They will try to obscure it. They'll try to hide it, as I said, like the Pharisees. But the light of the gospel, from our perspective, is ultimately designed to be revealed to all. We are to reveal it to all. We must let it shine, as it were. If it is hidden, it shouldn't stay that way. We're to reveal it so people can see it, so they can see Christ. Look at verse 22. It says, "Therefore nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light." I mean, these are literally two parallel statements that are just saying exactly the same thing. Nothing is hidden, nothing is secret. It will all be revealed. It will all be made manifest in the light. And you might ask the question, well, what is it that needs to be revealed? What is it that needs to be made manifest? Well, it's simply, as I've been saying, it's the message of Christ. It's Christ is to be revealed, the message of the kingdom. And what is the message of the kingdom? Jesus' message of the kingdom is repent and turn to Christ. That's the message that needs to be shining out there. Now, it may be hidden temporarily back then. It may be even hidden temporarily today, but that's not its ultimate goal. We need to reveal it. It needs to be fully revealed. And even if you remember, after Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, it was revealed in all its fullness when the disciples went out and preached it everywhere. And so the truth of Christ and the truth of the gospel must not be hidden. It must not be hidden. It must not be covered up at all. And you have to somewhat put yourself in the shoes of the disciples as you think of what Jesus is teaching here. I mean, this would have been huge encouragement to them who were with him at the time. And remember, we've talked about this before, Jesus didn't have a large group of followers at this time. Not genuine followers, true followers. But one day soon, those disciples that he chose especially, they're going to go out and they're going to unleash the gospel in the known world. And they're going to take it to the highways and to the byways, and they're going to pass it on, and they're going to share it to everybody. They're going to shine it out. So this message was just as much for them back then as it is for us today. But just like in those days, even today, we know that there are people who hide the truth. They want to hide the truth. They want to suppress Christ and his teaching. They try to snuff him out and pretend that he doesn't exist, or they try to ignore it. But the light still gets through, doesn't it? Thankfully. And it's our mandate, isn't it, that we need to shine the light of the gospel. You could go back to the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus says that very thing in Matthew 5, that we are to be lights. We are to shine the light of Jesus Christ, the light of the gospel. We're to proclaim Christ. And I mean, this is if you want a week during the year to proclaim Christ, this is the best week of the year leading up to Easter. What greater opportunity do we have to be able to talk about the things of Christ and the things of Christianity than leading right up to Easter? It's perfect for us to take that as a stepping stone to be able to preach Christ and share Christ with our friends and family and workmates and schoolmates. So take the opportunity to shine the light. Don't hide the truth under a bushel, Jesus is telling us. And then verse 23 is another reminder, a strong reminder to make sure that we're listening to what Jesus is saying. Look what it says. If anyone has ears, let him hear. This is an important message that we need to be mindful of, that we need to shine the light. We need to spread the truth. And so we need to listen carefully to what Jesus is saying. We need to tune in to what he's saying. We need to listen to his teaching. We need to listen to the words of Christ. And so the question for all of us is, how well am I listening? Am I truly listening to Jesus Christ and what he's saying in the gospel and in these gospels that we're looking at? And so it's an exhortation that is certainly relevant for us today. Are we listening? It's kind of like if Jesus was here talking to us this morning, he might be saying something like this to us. Are you listening to my message? I am the lamp. I am the light of the world. Follow me, Jesus would say. Don't hide me. Don't put a lid over me. But shine out my truth and my message to others in this world. And so we would need to be doing that. That's what he would want us to do. So if you're a kingdom citizen, if you're part of God's kingdom, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, this is what you're called to do, to shine your light and to shine the light of Jesus Christ in this dark world that we live in. The second thing I want us to notice from this passage is regarding the kingdom. And I've called it this, use it or lose it. But it's basically the idea that kingdom citizens need to make the most of God's word. You need to make the most of God's truth. Look at verse 24 and 25. Jesus goes on, he says to them, pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you, and still more will be added to you. For to the one who has, more will be given. And from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Now these verses, again, notice how they begin. They begin with an admonition for us to listen carefully. So all I can deduce from that is that whatever Jesus is saying here must be really important, because he's told us over and over again that we need to listen carefully to this. We need to listen to the truth, pay attention to what we hear from Christ. So again, are you listening carefully? Are you carefully reading and listening to the words of Christ? What are you doing with the truth? What are you doing with the truth that you have, the words of Christ? We have a huge responsibility to hear the words of Christ, and then when we hear them, we have a huge responsibility to do what is right with them. You know, it could very well be that this morning might be the last chance that some of you might ever get to hear the words of Christ. It might be that after today that God might close the door of your heart to the truth. The opportunity to hear the truth might be removed. And so these verses, I think, are really a warning for some of us. And if we keep rejecting the truth, when you look at Scripture and you look at what Jesus is saying here, if someone keeps rejecting the truth, then God at some point will reject that person. You think of the life of Pharaoh. That was true of Pharaoh. Pharaoh hardened his heart. We talked about this the other day. He hardened his heart many, many times, and then eventually God hardened his heart. Same with the Pharisees. They were in a similar boat. They rejected Christ, and Christ ultimately rejected them. Same with the scribes and many of the other religious leaders who were around at that time. And so Jesus is saying effectively to us, the way you handle the truth that you receive will determine whether you get any more of it or whether you get less of it. If you handle the biblical truth that you currently have, if you handle it with care and if you handle it with integrity, then Jesus is saying, well, you'll get more truth. If you respect the truth, if you learn it, if you obey it, if you embrace it, if you trust it, if you meditate on it, then more spiritual truth will be measured out to you. You'll get more. However, if you are stingy with God's truth, if you treat it with contempt, maybe you just ignore it, or perhaps you blow it off as unimportant, there will be consequences. There will come a time, maybe in your life, where God will remove that truth from you, and you won't have any. And so the question that we need to ask ourselves is, am I making the most of what has been measured out to me already? Am I making the most of the truth that I already know and have heard? Maybe you've heard the story of two men. One of them was a baker and one of them was a butcher. And rather than charging each other for their services and for their products, they would trade their goods with each other. And so the butcher, one day though, became very angry because the pound of flour that he was given for the pound of meat always came up short of a pound. He would get the flour, he'd measure, and it wouldn't be a pound. And so one day he went to the baker and he confronted the baker about it, and said, well, hey, you're not giving me a pound of flour like you said you were going to. And the baker said to him, well, my measurement on my scale, I don't have measurements. All I have is a balance. And so what I did was got your supposed pound of meat and I put it on my balance and I just put the flour to match the meat and then gave you the flour. And so his point was clear, obviously, right? The butcher himself had been trying to cheat the baker by giving him a bit of meat that wasn't a pound. He did not want the same, and then the butcher did not want the same standard of measure used against him. You know, if you shortchange God by failing to make the most of the truth you have been given, then there's a warning in place for you. Be warned. God might turn around, if you've been shortchanging him, he might turn around and shortchange you. I think this principle is especially pertinent to those of you who maybe are younger and you've grown up in Christian homes. Maybe you've been to church week after week, you've sat in pews, you've heard preaching, you've been exposed to the truth week after week, constantly listening to it, but you're doing nothing with it. This verse is a warning to you to beware, to watch out, because Scripture always tells us that you reap what you sow. If you ignore the truth, then God is fully entitled to withhold it from you. That's why I say here, use it or lose it. If you love the truth, then I encourage you to make the most of it, because then you'll never get enough of it. If you prize the truth, then more will be given to you, and your depth of understanding will grow and deepen as you love truth and deal with it with integrity and care. Then you'll be measured out more truth. Let me say it this way. The more that you would shine the light, maybe the more that you would spread the truth, the more that you would share the gospel, the more God will bless you with a greater joy and a greater understanding of the truth, and you will experience more joy and peace and contentment and satisfaction in your life if you deal with the truth properly. We certainly don't want to be like the Pharisees, right? Remember, they had the truth for a while. They had the Old Testament. They had the Old Testament law, but they abused it. They misinterpreted it. They mistreated it. And as a result, they will be condemned for that. And any truth that they might have held in their hands was really taken away from them. It was really of no benefit to them at all. And so we need to be responsible for the truth that we have, for the truth that we receive. We need to use it well, use it to help us grow. If you don't use it, Jesus is pointing out here that you might lose it. And if you lose it, you will die spiritually. Maybe even some of you ask yourself or think in your own life, why is it that sometimes I just feel so spiritually dry? Why does that happen to me? Why is it that sometimes I just feel like I'm not growing spiritually? I don't have that zeal, that spiritual zeal that I really want, or that I'm not really as passionate about truth as I should be. Maybe it's because you're just failing to follow what Jesus says here. You're not listening as well to truth as you should. You're not hearing the truth like you should. You're not reading his words like you should. Because the more that you fill your heart and the more that you fill your mind with truth and continue to meditate on it and continue to obey it and live it out, then the more you will receive. And the more you do that, I guarantee the more joy and passion and fervor and zeal that you'll have in your life. If the truth is not saturating your soul, you will dry up spiritually. That will happen. Well, kingdom citizens, that's what we do. We need to make the most of God's truth. Let me give you a third thing that kingdom citizens do, and that is while you're sleeping, God causes kingdom growth. He causes kingdom growth, and we are to trust in his perfect plan as he does that. Look at verses 26 to 29. Let me read them. Jesus goes on, he said, "The kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come." And so here Jesus once again uses this metaphor, uses this parable of sowing seed. And as I said earlier, parables were usually about the kingdom of God, just as this one is as well. And the kingdom of God, as I said, is God's reign. It's God's rule over his people. Jesus, remember, is the king. And Jesus is building his kingdom by calling people to be a part of his kingdom and saving people. And so this parable, I think it's fairly straightforward. It's basically the seed would be scattered here by the farmer. It lands out on the soil. And essentially, that's what the farmer did in those days. That's all he really had to do, get the seed and sow the seed. And in those days, they obviously didn't have big irrigators or anything like that. They trusted in God for the rain. They didn't have any fertilizer that I know of anyway, but they just sowed the seed and then left it to do its thing. Maybe they pulled out some weeds, I don't know. They planted the seed and left it. And so after sowing the seed, the process of growth would just essentially take care of itself. The sun would shine, the rain would come, the seed would germinate, it would grow, it would grow larger, the grain would be formed, and then eventually you would have a harvest. That was how it happened. And all the while that's happening, the farmer, he's not doing anything. He's gone off to bed. And then he sleeps and he gets up again. He does that day after day. He doesn't need to do anything else, really. He just needs to wait patiently. That's what he does. And it's an incredible process that takes place once that seed gets in the dirt it's a process that we really have no idea of how it happens. I think there's a few soil scientists that are part of this church. They might have a little bit of more of an idea of what goes on in the soil. But you know what? Essentially, we have no idea how this happens. This is God at work. It's a mystery that a little seed could become a plant. And how that happens is almost hard to know. But God knows. It's a divine process. From our perspective, it's a mystery. We might ask, what's the point of this parable? Well, the parable's a little bit like the parable of the soils from last time. Basically this, in God's kingdom, the citizens sow the seed. We are to sow the seed. We are to preach the gospel. We are to go everywhere and preach the gospel and share the truth and shine the light and do all of that. And then, once we've done that, the Lord takes over. He does the work. He saves the lost. He opens the blind eyes. He regenerates dead souls. Because spiritual work is God's work. Spiritual life can never begin with human effort. It can never begin with manipulation or human ingenuity or man-centered techniques or market-driven strategies. Salvation, we sang it this morning, is a work of God. It's a work of God. Our responsibility is to faithfully sow the seed. We do have a part to play. We've got to sow the seed. And God will produce the good soil, and God will produce the harvest. And we don't always comprehend what God's doing, do we? But we need to trust him, and we need to be patient in our trusting of him. And so the question for us really as we look at this passage is are we sowing seeds? Are you sowing seeds in your life? Are you sharing the gospel with people? Are you inviting people to hear the gospel? Another great opportunity, like I said before, Easter service coming up. I'm going to preach the gospel next Sunday morning. Right here at this time, you can be sure that I'm going to preach the gospel. If you know somebody who needs to hear it, invite them because they need to hear it. Are you sowing seeds? Not just on a Sunday morning, but are you sowing seeds throughout the week? You could be sharing your testimony informally with somebody. That's a way to sow seed. You could be speaking about the excellencies of God in your conversation with the people, about how awesome God is and what he's doing in your life. You can shine the light. You can sow the seeds through your words, through your conversations, even through your attitudes and your responses and your actions and all of the activities that you're involved in. You can share the light. You can sow the seed through your life and through your lips. You can do it both ways. And once you've done that, we have absolutely no idea what God is going to do with it. In some cases, you won't know until you get to heaven how God has used the seed that you've sown. But you must sow the seed. You must do it. You can't avoid doing that. That's our responsibility. We have to do it. You can't ignore that. That's our part to play. If you're not sowing seed, you're being unfaithful. You're not being obedient to Christ. You must sow the seed, and then, like the farmer, we go off to bed. We sleep. We wake up. We get up, but all the while God is working with that seed. And so we need to be seed sowing machines. You know what God is doing? Far more than we can think or imagine. You know, I think part of sowing a seed is I know many of you like to pray for your families. You like to pray for your children, maybe your grandchildren, maybe your spouses, your extended family, friends, that they would come to know the Lord. That's part of the process of sowing the seed and watering the seed as well. Maybe even through some of your acts of kindness or moments of compassion or words of encouragement or verses that you might share with somebody or post on Facebook or whatever you do with them, or emails that you might send to people just expressing appreciation and thankfulness, or handing out a tract to somebody or leaving a tract somewhere in a public place. Those kind of things are opportunities too for seeds to be sown. So those are all part of what it means to sow seeds. And when we do those things, if we pray about those things, then God will take those things and he will do incredible work with them. You know, sometimes it might feel like your Christian activity is just not going anywhere. Maybe you might think it's pointless. Maybe you even get a little bit discouraged. You think you might be sowing seeds. But you know what? Don't worry about that, because we don't always know what God's doing. Remember the words of 1 Corinthians 3, verses 6 and 7, right? Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, but then what? But God gave the growth. So So God's doing it behind the scenes. And then Paul even says this, so neither he who plants or he who waters is anything. He's talking about us. We're not really anything in this process, but God who gives the growth. All glory and praise would go to him because he should get credit for what happens. And so God is growing his kingdom. And he uses us in that process to sow the seeds, to sow the gospel seeds. And then we wait patiently and expectantly as we watch that seed grow and maybe have the blessing, not necessarily of always watching it grow, but maybe even having the blessing of seeing a harvest come in. Well, let me give you the last one, the fourth thing that we learn from this passage regarding the kingdom of God, and that is what I've said, from insignificant to incomprehensible. And this is the idea that God's kingdom is going to grow beyond our wildest dreams. Look at verse 30. It says there, Jesus said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable shall we use for it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which when sown on the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes larger than all the garden plants and puts out large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. And so this final parable is about a mustard seed, a small mustard seed. It's also recorded over in Matthew 13, verses 31 and 32. But again, this gives us another description of what the kingdom of God is going to be like. It's going to be like a grain of mustard seed, the smallest garden plant seed in Israel in Christ's time. And the mustard seed would grow into this large plant. These mustard seeds would become plants that were potentially 3 or 4 meters high as the ceiling here in this building. Large enough to provide shelter, large enough for birds to come and perch in them. And the point of the parable is to show us the contrast between the beginning and the end of God's kingdom. See, the parable describes this incredible growth that's going to take place in God's kingdom. Remember, it began very small. Jesus, the king of this kingdom, was born in a manger in Bethlehem. It was a very, very humble beginning. And Jesus gathered around him just these 12 ordinary guys, a bunch of fishermen, a bunch of regular guys. And then I've said to you, at the time of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, there was only about 500 or 600 people who were truly following Jesus at this time. And so comparatively speaking, that's pretty small. It's a pretty small group. But then it began to blossom. You look at the early church, you think of Peter on the day of Pentecost, right? Peter gets up, preaches. How many got saved? 3,000 people were saved in that one sermon. The church, the kingdom just continues to flourish. And it's continued to grow right up until today. And God's kingdom has advanced beyond measure. We can't hardly even measure it. You know, we've seen revivals all around the world over the years. And there's still revivals and great spurts of growth happening in the church and in the kingdom all around the world, whether it be in Europe or Russia or parts of Africa or Asia. God's kingdom is growing, even spread to little old New Zealand, right? And we're thankful for that, that his kingdom has grown down this part of the planet. So what started out as something very small, something insignificant, becomes very large. It becomes incomprehensible. God is building his kingdom. The gates of hell are not going to prevail against it. God's kingdom started small, but it is huge and it is still growing. That's the idea of this parable here. And I think this parable just reminds us too of the greatness of God. Think about how he could do this. This is the greatness of God on display, that he could take something very small, make it as big as it is today. Our God is an awesome God, and his army is growing massive. And the culmination of all of this kingdom will be when Christ the King comes back again. We looked at this in Revelation 19. Christ is going to come back, as I said, and he's going to set up his kingdom, establish his earthly kingdom. It will be massive compared to that little tiny group of followers that he had in those early days. Such spectacular growth. That's what the kingdom is going to be like. And then Mark finishes up the section just with a couple of verses, a brief summary there. He says, with many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. And he did not speak to them without a parable, but privately to his own disciples, he explained everything. And so what we have recorded in Mark's gospel, in fact, what we have recorded in all of the gospel, is not all of the parables that Jesus taught. There were many, many more, but only some of them have been recorded. But But as we've seen already, Jesus would often explain the details of those parables to his disciples. Well, I trust that there are some great lessons in this message for us today, just some things that we can take out of it, just to remind ourselves about. And I trust that you're playing your part as a citizen in God's kingdom, that you too would be shining the light, that you would be shining your faith, that you would be magnifying Christ, that you would be sowing those seeds, that you would be making the most of God's word. You know, we know that God will faithfully and sovereignly take care of his responsibility in the kingdom. He is working behind the scenes, but we too need to play our part, don't we? We need to be faithful. We need to be faithful to sow the seeds and shine the light as he's called us to do. Let's bow our head and even ask him to help us in that process. Father, we are mindful again that you've called us and given us responsibilities to be shining lights, to be shining you the lights, to be sowing seeds. And Lord, I just pray that you'd help us to be faithful to do that. Lord, it's not always easy. Sometimes we find that challenging. We find it hard. We're lazy. We procrastinate. We're scared. We're afraid of what people might say or do. But Lord, I pray that you'd give us a willingness to be bold and to be obedient to you so that we can share the truth of the gospel with a lost and a dying world that need to hear the life-saving truth. Help us do that, Lord, as we go out this week, as we interact with people in our community. Lord, as we head towards Easter, I pray that we would be able to use that as a wonderful starting point to be able to speak of Christ and all that he has done for us. So Lord, help us to be faithful to do that, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.